everyone. Can you hear me? Okay, so welcome to, 16A review session for Module 1 and Module 3. My name is Alice. This is Sarika and Nirman, and so we'll be helping to go over some questions today. We don't have review slides, so if you have any, like, sort of questions about, how we kind of arrived at an answer or any, like, conceptual questions, feel free to stop us at any point and ask questions. So the first question that we're gonna do is this question. It's called APS Lab by Hand. It's from Spring 18 exam, question number 8. So if any of you wanted to bring up the question and follow along on your computers, you're welcome to as well. And this one sort of covers a bit of correlation and also trilateration. I guess I'll give everyone a couple minutes to take a look at the question and then think about sort of how they might go about answering it. And then we can discuss together. Let's talk over the question together. I'm having some technical difficulties. So this question says that we have a couple beacon signals, and you can treat these as like elements that are traveling at a velocity of 1 meter per second. And then your beacons are located some distance d away from the microphone. And this is in units of meters. Okay, so we're first going to consider sort of the 1D case where we have two beacons, and then we're trying to detect the position of something along a line. And so we have two different signals coming between each beacon. So first beacon, beacon A, is transmitting, this signal here, and then beacon B is transmitting this signal here. And so the whole system looks something like this. So the first part is, let's suppose that we have a microphone located at x equals 0. So we put our microphone right here. What is the signal that the microphone is going to receive from the two beacons? So does anyone have any suggestions on how we might go about approaching this? Okay, so let's first think about what will happen from the signal going from A as it transmits to the microphone located at XM, right? So we know that the signal is moving at 1 meter per second, right? So let's say that signal A first transmits a 1 from beacon A, and then that 1 is going to be transmitting at a speed of 1 meter per second to XM. So how many seconds is it going to take until it reaches XM, which is a distance of 10 meters away? 10 seconds, right? Okay, so the first signal in A is going to take 10 seconds to get to the microphone. Now what about B? What's going to happen here? How long will it take to get for the first signal of B to transmit to the microphone? Also 10 seconds, right? Okay, so that means that between the delay from the beacon to the microphone for A and B are the same, right? Each of them has the same delay. So then microphone is going to start receiving signal A and B at the same time. And then when it receives those signals, the signals get added to each other, right? So in this case, our raw signal is just going to be the sum of A and B with some 10-second delay, right? So if we add those two signals together, then we'll just get 1 plus 1, which equals 2, 0, the 1 from A, 1 from B, and then some more zeros. Sounds good? Okay, so now let's try to move on to the next question. So now let's say that we received a different raw signal. So before we had this raw signal, assuming that the position was in the middle, but now we have something different, right? So if you take a look at the ones over here, they're at different location from before. And so the question here is, what is the smallest time delay between when the signals arrive? I guess the question is, we want to figure out what the difference between when signal A is arriving versus when signal B is arriving. So I'll let everyone kind of think about it a bit again. Yep. Oh yeah, sorry. Let me see if I can copy them down. So A is 1 0 1 0 0 0 0, and then B is 1 0 0. So taking a look at this question, since we're asked for sort of the delay between when the signal's arriving, is there like a technique that we've learned to figure out what the delay is of a signal? Yeah, we can do cross-correlation, right? So we can go ahead and try to cross-correlate signals A and B with the raw signal and see where the peak of the correlation is, and that will give us an indication of what the delay is. Remember the equation of cross-correlation, which is the correlation onto some signal of, say, A or B in this case, is equal to the sum of the product of the, the received signal and then the shifted beacon signal. For I equals negative infinity to infinity. And so one key thing to note about this question is that the signals are periodic, meaning that they're sort of repeating themselves in both positive infinity and negative infinity of time. So let's go ahead and try to take the cross-correlation. So maybe we'll first try out correlation between signal A and the raw signal. I'm going to use the table method to calculate the correlation. You may have also tried other methods. So if we put the raw signal here, so we have 2, 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0. And then I'll first take A with a shift of 0. So and A is going to just be 1, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0. And so all you have to do is multiply all of the columns and then sum up all of the multiplied numbers. So I'll multiply 2 times 1 to get 2. And then this is 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. Okay, and then if we sum all these numbers together, then we get 2. Okay, so this is going to be my correlation of SA onto R at 0. Everyone with me so far? Yeah? Okay. Basically we can kind of repeat this for the next step. So we can go ahead and shift SA by 1. So 2 0 0 1 0 1 0, and then everything gets moved over by 1. And because this is a periodic signal, the last signal becomes like, or the last number becomes like the first number in my shifted signal. So I have 0 first, then 1 0 1 0 0 0. So we can go ahead and calculate this one. Everything is 0 except the 1 here. So if we sum up the 1 and all the zeros, we get 1. So that's sort of the idea of correlation. I don't want to make everyone sit through the rest of the calculation, so I'll just write out the solution. After kind of doing all of this, then we'll find that the correlation of SA with R is 2 0 3 0, and then the correlation with SB is going to be 3 0 1 2 1 1 0. Okay. So now that we've found the correlations, how can we get the delay from this? Yep. Right. So first, we want to find the peak of where the correlation is, right? So we have one here. And then we have 1 here. And then you're saying to subtract the 2 from each other. So do you want to, so in this case, we have SA has from 0 delay of 5, right? And then SB has like a delay of 0. And so sort of the first idea is like, okay, so maybe we can just take SA minus SB's delay and get a delay of 5. So the other thing we also want to think about is that maybe, since it's a periodic signal, right, like this correlation is actually repeating, right? So if I try to extend SA into the opposite, into the negative direction, the correlation will kind of continue. 0, 3, going this way as well, right? So this is also like another peak. And so in this case, the other thing you could observe is that the delay between A to B could be that SA is actually 2 steps in front of SB as well. Like both of these options are valid. Since we're looking for like the minimum time delay or the smallest one, in this case, I would say it's actually that SB is delayed 2 steps after SA. So smallest. Time delay is 2 steps. SA before SB. Okay. Any questions so far? Yep. How do I got to 2 steps? Oh, okay. That's a good question. So, we know that, for periodic correlation, the correlation signal is also going to be periodic. So it will be a pattern and it will repeat itself with the same period as the signal. And so signal SA has a period of 7 numbers and it's going to keep on repeating itself, right? So that means that if we take a look at just the calculated correlation for 1 period, that will tell us the difference between SA and SB in 1 direction, but actually, since it's periodic, like the correlation will also extend into sort of like the negative case. And if you consider the repeated signal, then actually like SB, you can see that SB actually has a delay of 2 after SA. Does that answer your question? Or? Okay. Any other questions? Okay, so let's go ahead and try out the next part then. So based on this answer of using like the smallest time step of 2 steps, how can we figure out where the microphone is located? Okay, so what would you say, so let's first think about it. So let's go ahead and try and see what happens if we shift it 2 steps towards A. So then the delay from A to the this location will be 8, right? Right, yeah, so. Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. So let me go ahead and erase this. So that's correct. So if we go ahead and place the mic at -1, then you'll see that the delay from A to the mic is 9, and the delay from B to the mic is 11. So then 11 minus 9 will give you 2. Okay, great. Okay, so I think in the interest of time, I'll skip part D for now. But I suggest to take a look at it on your own time. And let's go ahead and try out part E next. So it turns out that our 1D microphone setup is not so accurate, and we'd like to actually consider things in 2 dimensions. So now let's say that we have sort of the same setup, so the same raw signal, but then we want to sort of solve for like all the different possible solutions in 2 dimensions. And so we have some hints here. So the delay is going to be the same. And then it should still give the same answer to us as when we solved the 1D case. But now we're just considering 2 dimensions. So I'd like everyone to maybe think about it for a few seconds, and then we'll try to discuss together again. Does anyone have any ideas of something that we've learned before that might be kind of helpful? Maybe I can draw a picture. So let's say that we have our beacon A and beacon B. And so in the 2-dimensional case, we're saying that, like, let's say we put the mic like over here, right? And we want to try to figure out like where the position of the mic is, right? And then the mic will, using correlation, we can figure out what the distance is from the mic to each of the beacons. And so that's kind of like this problem where we'll know the distance of the mic from one of them, but it could be anywhere within a radius around each beacon, right? So this looks really similar to our trilateration problems, right? So we can kind of think back to how we went about solving those. And we know that we can solve this just by setting up the equations for the circle around the beacon, right? So in this case, if we were to consider the distance of the microphone from beacon A, we know that dA squared equals the x distance squared and then the y distance squared. So that'll just be x mic minus xA squared plus y mic minus yA squared. And then we can go ahead and do the same thing for B. So dB squared equals x mic minus xB squared plus y mic minus yB squared. Okay. And so then, since we want to find an expression for all the possible solutions, we'd like to try to simplify this equation a little bit, right? So one way that we can do this is that we can try to subtract or eliminate some of the equations. So I'll subtract the first equation from the second equation. And then we'll get dA squared minus dB squared equals xm minus xA squared minus xm minus xB squared plus ym minus yA squared minus ym minus yB squared. Okay. And then we're given some parameters that we already know. So xA is going to be minus 10 and yA is 0. xB is 10 and yB is 0. So we can go ahead and substitute these things in. And then the distance from the of the microphone from the beacons, we also know that the difference between the distances is going to be a delay of 2, right? So let's go ahead and write this up. xA equals minus 10, yA equals 0, xB equals 10, and yB equals 0. We know that dB equals dA plus 2 from earlier. Okay, so substituting everything in now, we'll just get that dA squared minus dA plus 2 squared equals xm minus negative 10 squared minus xm minus xb, which is 10 squared, plus ym minus ya squared minus ym minus yb, which is also 0 squared. Okay. We'll notice a couple things. So one is that the yms will cancel each other out. The last step is to basically just check and make sure that this still works for our previous situation, right? If we were to solve for what dA is, from the question before, we know that dA should equal 9, and then we position the microphone at a location negative 1. So as a reminder, taking a look at this question over here, right? So if we substitute xm equals minus 1, then we'll get dA squared minus dA squared plus 4dA plus 4 equals xm. So xm equals minus 1 plus 10 squared minus 1 minus 10 squared. These two numbers will cancel. Then we'll get 4dA plus 4 equals 9 squared minus 121. So in the end, I think this should work out that dA equals 9. So you can see that even though we're substituting everything into the trilateration equation, it still gives us the same solution as the 1D case. Any questions about this part? Okay, if not, then I'll pass the microphone to Sarika. Oh, yeah, sure. So in part B, we calculated the correlations of both of the signals. And then we found that the peak of the correlation from for signal A was at sort of like the delay of 5 time step, and then the peak signal signal B is delay of 2 time step. So we mentioned that because the signals are periodic, that 5 time step delay could also mean that signal A is coming 2 time steps before signal B, and so then we decided the smallest time delay is 2 steps.
Can everyone hear me? Okay, great. So now we're going to be going through Spring 19. The final exam, and this will be question number 3, which is an application of least squares. So the idea here is we have a sensor, and it's trying to measure the distance between the sensor and an object. Okay, so take a few minutes to just look at the problem and familiarize yourself with it, and then we'll go through it together. Anyone need some more time? Raise your hand if you'd like a minute or two more. Okay, great. So in this problem, we have this sensor here that tries to detect this distance S of the position of the object on this line, and it outputs some voltage V, which is going to be some function of this distance S. So we're given this table here, which has basically a list of positions versus voltage measurements. And so the idea is we want to figure out what exactly this function is between our sensor output and our voltage, or sorry, and our distance of the object. Okay, so in part A here, we start by assuming that our position is approximated by scaled voltage. So basically, our position S is equal to some constant K times V. But we don't know what this constant K is, so we're trying to figure out the K that minimizes our squared error S minus KV norm squared. So can someone tell me how we might start approaching this? Any ideas? What have we learned that minimizes this function? Least squares, exactly. So we can just go ahead and apply our least square solution, assuming that our solution looks something like this, S is equal to K times V. Okay, so first of all, recall that our least square solution is X hat is equal to A transpose A inverse times A transpose times B for system A times X is equal to B, right? So in this case, how does this translate to this problem? So what is our A matrix? Our A matrix is going to be our measurements, our voltage measurements, V, right? So that's going to be 4, 10, 15, right? Our X here, this is going to be our unknown, which in this case is K, this scalar K, and then B is going to be S, so our position, so the object's position, which is 1, 2, 3. Okay, so this is our setup, so we can go ahead and just apply our least squares solution. So K, or K hat, is equal to A transpose A inverse, so A transpose is 4, 10, 15, times regular 4, 10, 15, this whole thing inverse, times A transpose, which is 4, 10, 15, times B, which is 1, 2, 3. And we can go ahead and solve. Let's work out the math for this problem since we don't actually have to for the rest of the parts. So this should end up being 1 over 16 plus 100 plus 225 times this product here, which is 4 plus 20 plus 45. And that gives us our final answer, which is just 69 over 341. And that's what we've approximated for K. Are there any questions about this part? No? Okay. Sounds good. All right. So once you finish kind of looking at that, this time we measure the output voltage to be negative 3 at position S is equal to 0. So we think that there might be a bias in the sensor. So it's not just going to be S is equal to K times V. It's going to be K times V plus some constant B, right? So it'll be an affine transformation instead of a linear one. Okay. So in this case, we want to set up our least squares equation or solution using this new model, S is equal to KV plus B. So take a minute or two to do that. Remember, you don't actually have to solve, but just get this set up. Okay, so for this part, what is our A matrix and our X matrix and everything? What is it going to look like? What are our unknowns in this problem? Anyone? So they're K and B. So our unknown, so our X vector, is going to be K and B because we're trying to fit this affine model to our measurements, right? So to set up this matrix, we know that K is going to be times X, or it's going to be times v in this case. So v is going to be negative 3, 4, 10, 15, and this is all times kb. What goes in the second column here? Exactly. So it's going to be a column of 1s, because we know that b is just multiplied by 1 in this model here. Okay. So, and this whole thing is going to equal s. So our object's position, which is 0, 1, 2, 3, like that. Okay, so this is going to be our setup, ax is equal to b. And like before, we're trying to minimize the squared error, so we can just apply the least squares formula. Okay, so to set this up, we have that x hat is equal to a transpose, which is negative 3, 4, 10, 15, and 1, 1, 1, 1 times a. That whole thing inverse times a transpose again. I'll just put this on the next line. So times a transpose times b, which is again 0, 1, 2, 3. And this is how we get our approximates for k and b. Are there any questions about this part? Okay, great. So moving on to the next part. So here we have a different sensor, and we take more data points, and these data points don't exactly follow our model from B very well, so it's no longer going to be an affine transformation. So by inspection, we decide either a quadratic or a logarithmic fit is going to work. So something like this. So we have these two models here, rather than our previous linear and affine models. So now we want to set up the least squares problems for these two models using the data in this table here. So similar to before. So take a few moments to try and work this out. Remember, don't actually solve, just set up the least squares formula. Does anyone want a few more minutes? Okay, so let's start going over the quadratic setup for a quadratic model. Okay, so in this case, we know our unknowns. So for A, x is equal to b, our unknowns are going to be a2, a1, and 0, right? And a0, because we're trying to find the best fit for those parameters. Okay, and so what is our A matrix going to look like? Any ideas? Yeah. Exactly. So it's going to be a column of v squared. So because recall that our model looks like this. It's a2 times v squared plus a1 plus times v plus a0. So the first column is just going to be all our values v squared. So that's going to be 20 squared, 45 squared, 98 squared, and 214 squared. Our second column is going to be just a column of v's, so it's going to be 20, 45, 98, and 214. And then our final one is just going to be a row of 1's, because we know that a0 is multiplied just by 1. Okay, so that's our A matrix, and then our B matrix is the same as before, so it's just going to be our S values, so 4, 5, 6, and 7. Okay. And from here, we just plug in our A and our B into the formula, x hat equals A transpose A inverse A transpose B. Yeah. Any questions about that part? Okay, cool. So now for our logarithmic setup, recall our equation is S is equal to B1 times ln of V plus B0. So in this case, we know that our X vector is going to be B1, B0, because these are our unknowns. What is our A matrix going to look like? The first column is just going to be all ln of V, right? So ln of each of the V's in the table. So ln 20, ln 45, let's see, ln 98 and ln 214. And our second column is just going to be all 1's, because again, B0 is just multiplied by the constant 1. Okay, great. And again, we want to apply this least squares formula here. Okay, are there any questions about any of these parts so far? Okay, great. So moving on to our last part, which is part D. So we're given these errors, right? So we're given this table of errors where E is equal to S approximate minus actual S, S measured, for the sets of data in that part. So our question is, in the context of least squares, which is the better fit? And justify your answer mathematically. Just take a minute or two to think about that, and then we'll talk about it together. Would anyone like some more time to think about this? Raise your hand. Okay, just a minute more then. Okay, so let's start talking about this part. So again, what we're trying to do is find which of these models is the better fit in the context of least squares. Okay, so my first question is, what is the cost function that we're trying to minimize in least squares? It's the norm of ax hat minus b squared, right? Where ax hat is our estimate, and this B is our actual. Right, so this is our actual measurement, whereas AX hat is, given the model that we're trying to look at, what is our estimated position for a given voltage. Okay, so using this formula, we can sort of figure out which of the overall cost is going to be lower given the two different models. Okay, so our cost for the quadratic case. So we're already given here, we're given our errors, so we can just square them and add them together just by this cost function equation. So the cost for the quadratic is going to be 1 squared plus negative 1.5 squared plus 0.5 squared plus 0 squared, and that ends up being 3.5. And so the cost now for logarithmic, we do the exact same thing. We just square all of our errors and add them together. And that gives us negative 0.9 squared plus 0 squared plus negative 1 squared plus 1.1 squared, which is 3.02. Okay, so given these two costs, which one is the better fit? It's going to be the logarithmic, right? So logarithmic is better fit. Because the overall cost when we use our logarithmic model is lower, and our goal in least squares is to minimize the cost as much as we can. Okay. Are there any questions about this problem? Or least squares in general? Yeah. Oh, yeah. So we don't actually use it just because we just use it in the setup for each of these problems. Though, theoretically, if you had actually solved these out, that would give you your estimates, which you can use to subtract with the actual position in order to get these errors here. Yeah. Any other questions? Okay, if there are no other questions, I'm going to pass the mic to Nirman.
Hello? Can people hear me?
Alright, cool. So the problem I'm going to be going over is this constraint least squares problem. So the basic idea is we're trying to considering a matrix A of full column rank where m is greater than n, we're trying to determine a unit vector x that minimizes the norm of Ax. So this equivalent, and we're trying to we have this constraint where the norm of x is 1. So this argument kind of looks like a least squares kind of thing. So like in least squares, we're trying to minimize x for ax minus b. So in this case, b equals 0, right? So x hat would be like, if that's a transpose a inverse, a transpose b, that would give us 0. But the x hat can't actually be 0, right? Because we have a constraint where the norm of x is equal to 1. So in this problem, we're trying to we can't use a regular least squares approach. So we have to do this modified constrained least squares optimization. And this problem helps us guide us through it. So it's a bunch of inner product proofs that I think would be good practice. So in the first part, so in the setup, we have these eigenvalue eigenvector pairs for A transpose A, and we're assuming that all the eigenvalues are real and are indexed in ascending order. So the first part is just trying to show that the smallest eigenvalue is greater than 0. So let's spend a few minutes thinking about that. Oh yeah, this is from spring 2017, if you want to follow along. Question 6. Yeah. Oh yeah, during this final exam, the professors decided to have this wave thing, so if you didn't know how to do it, you could just get 10% of the credit. It depends on the professors each semester if they do it, so I can't say if it'll happen this semester or not. So do people have any thoughts? Like how to start? So the way I would like start this problem is that we're interested in lambda 1, right? So we know that lambda 1 is an eigenvalue of A transpose A. So in particular, we have that A transpose A times some V1 equals lambda 1 V1, right? So if I were taking this exam, what I would see, like, this A transpose A shows up here in particular, right? So let's consider the, so that would motivate me to, like, let's consider the quantity A V1. Right, because that will give us V1 transpose times A1, A transpose A times V1, right? And then we have that V1 is an eigenvector of A transpose A, so that lets us substitute this expression, so we get V1 transpose times lambda 1 times V1, which gives us this. So that would give us lambda 1 times the norm of V1 squared, right? So we can solve for lambda 1 now. So we get lambda 1 is the norm of AV1 divided by the norm of V1. These should be squares. Right? So how does this help us? Like, so we have an expression for lambda 1. How does this help us show that lambda 1 is greater than 0? Yeah. 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 So we have that these are norm squares. So these are at least like positive semi-definite numbers, like they're non-negative, right? So like at the very least, we can say that lambda 1 is greater than or equal to 0. But so now we have to show like why can't lambda 1 be 0, right? So if lambda 1 were equal to 0, that would mean that A times V1 would equal to 0, right? So obviously V1 is not equal to 0. So the only way this would be true is if V1 was in the null space of A, right? But if you go back to the beginning of the problem, it says that the matrix A is a full column rank. So there's no null space. So therefore, lambda 1 cannot be equal to 0 as well. So the way I would structure the proof is I would first show that lambda 1 is at least greater than or equal to 0, and then you have to like show the subcase why lambda 1 can't be equal to 0. Cool. So the second part of the problem is we're considering these two eigenpairs like corresponding to lambda k and l, which are distinct eigenvalues of A transpose A. So now we want to prove that the eigenvectors of different eigenvalues are orthogonal. So they gave us like a few hints, so I'll give you a few minutes to think about it. many people would like some more time? All right. So let's like follow the hint. So the first thing says pre-multiply the first equation by WL transpose. So that will give us WL transpose A transpose A times VK. And then doing the same thing on the other side, we get this. And then the second one says post-multiply the second equation by VK. So we get VL transpose A VK equals lambda L VL transpose VK. So what we notice is that the left-hand sides of both of these equations are the same, right? So that means we can set the right-hand sides equal to each other, or another way you can do that is just we can subtract the two equations. So the left-hand side of the subtraction will give us zero, and then we can get lambda k times VL transpose times VK minus lambda L VL transpose VK. So that gives us lambda k minus lambda L times the inner product of VL and VK, right? So how does this help us show that the two eigenvectors are orthogonal? Yep. So since this is a product of two scalars, at least one of the scalars better be zero, right? But in the beginning of the problem, we say that lambda k cannot equal to lambda l. So since lambda k does not equal to lambda l, like this expression, this scalar cannot be equal to zero. So that means the inner product better be zero. So that means that the eigenvectors are orthogonal to each other. All right, so the next part says, like, okay, so now we know that they're mutually orthogonal, and each of them has unit length, so they can form an orthonormal basis for Rn. So that means we can express an arbitrary vector x and Rn as a linear combination, as follows. So this is expressing as a linear combination. So now the first part is just saying, what is the nth coefficient alpha n in the linear combination. So in this part, so we know that they're each orthogonal to each other, and we're interested in particular alpha n. So we want to somehow solve for alpha n in this problem, right? So one way we can do that, since we know that they're orthogonal, we would be motivated to take the inner product of, like, x with vn. Right, so let's do that. So on the other side, we would have the sum of from I equals I equals 1 to n of alpha n times the inner product of v. I changed the index to I, but v, vn, and vi. So all the terms. So I'm going to change the index to I. So that'll be alpha I times V and inner product with VI. So the only term that will survive is the V, is the case where I equals to N, right? So that'll give us alpha N times VN VN, right? And since each of the eigenvectors have unit length, this just equals alpha n. So that means that alpha n is just simply equal to the inner product of vn times nx for this part. And you could have immediately written this without doing this like inner product argument by simply knowing that we just need to project onto vn because they're orthogonal to each other. So then part two is, like, suppose x is a unit length vector. Now we want to show that all the sum of the squares of the weights equals 1. So spend a few minutes thinking about that. So we're given that x is a unit length vector, so that means like the norm, or even the norm squared is equal to 1. So like the inner product of x with itself will just be 1. So we can just substitute, so we have an expression for x, so we can just substitute that down here. So we'll have, so this is going to be x transpose x, which is just going to be the sum from I equals 1 to n of alpha I VI transpose, and the other one would be from like J to 1, J equals 1 to N of alpha J VJ. So we can just like bring the sums over, so that'll give us this, the J times the inner product of VI and VJ. So now let's, in this sum, what terms will contribute? Like which ones will not be zero? Right. So we know that the eigenvectors are mutually orthogonal to each other. So the only terms that will be one is if I equals to J. So that means we can write this as So like we can write this as from I equals 1 to n of alpha I squared, and then the inner product is always 1. So since the original inner product equals 1, so the sum of the weights better be 1. So this was equal to 1, so I just brought that over. So yeah, that proves that. Are any questions about this part? So now part D is like we're trying to solve the original problem. Like how do we minimize the norm of AX with X being a unit vector? So we basically want to like use the previous parts. Like we have a lot of information now. Like how can we use that information to prove, like find the minimum? So let's start going over. So we're interested in the quantity, the norm of AX. So that gives us X transpose A transpose A times X. So the previous part was like hinting that we should probably use like a similar expansion to like this. So substituting that in, we'll get equals 1. N of alpha I bi transpose times A times another sum. Right? And we know that these eigenvectors are these Vs are eigenvectors of A transpose A, so we can bring that over and simplify this as follows. And then we can use a similar argument to here, right? So we can like combine the sums, and then we'll get a bunch of inner products with vi and vj. So the only terms I'll contribute is when I equals to j, right? So then we can simplify this to be as follows. And then the inner product of vi with itself will be 1. So ax squared will equal something like this. So now the question is, okay, how do I minimize this? Like, what should I pick X to be equal to? Like, I want this to be small, right? So this would be like alpha 1 squared times lambda 1 plus alpha 2 squared times lambda 2 and so on. So how do I minimize that? So we want, since the lambdas are in ascending order, we want to pick the smallest lambda possible, right? So in particular, we want all the weight to be to the smallest eigenvector, to the smallest eigenvalue. So what vector X would accomplish that? So it'd be V1, right? Because that will make sure that the only alpha 1, the only alpha that will contribute is alpha 1. So we should pick x equals to lambda 1, or not lambda 1, d1. And then the norm of ax will equal lambda 1. And the first part is, the reason we like how do you like show the part 1 was that lambda 1 is positive is because it's just like to ensure, like, just to verify, like, the norm can't be negative. Like, that would be not right. So that's what the first part was trying to, like, accomplish. Are there any questions about the proof? Yeah, so we know that VJs are eigenvectors of A transpose A. So we can just, like, bring this in. So A transpose A times VJ will just equal lambda J times VJ through... because it's an eigenvector. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Oh yeah, because so we want this to be as small as possible, right? So it'll be like we want to pick the smallest eigenvalue, right? So because, like, if we pick a bigger one, like, if there's a component with a larger eigenvalue, that will, like, increase our sum. So we want to minimize this, so we just pick all the alphas to contribute to alpha 1. I mean, to lambda 1. Yeah, so therefore x is just equal to v1. Yep. Other questions? I think we're basically out of time, right? All right, if you want to start, though. Yeah. So for the rest of the 5 minutes, we can just, like, have, like, off, like, general questions about, like, the exam or anything about Module 3. So if you have any questions, feel free to ask them. Otherwise, yeah, that's, like, the end of the review session. Yeah, thanks.